and fitness. But the key word here is weight loss. So let me tell you, this word weight loss is a clickbait. We are not going to focus on weight loss. Weight loss is a very, very wrong way of understanding our fitness level or our any type of benchmark. It's a very shallow way of understanding our fitness. What we shall focus definitely on is fat loss. So there's a big difference between weight loss and fat loss. There can be slim people who are extremely weak and unhealthy. And, you know, they may have high cholesterol and they may have high blood pressure and all that. And there may be fat, apparently fat looking people who are really healthy. Their blood pressure is fine. Their heart pulse rate is fine. They have less cholesterol. They have no diabetes. So there it goes. How much you weigh is not necessarily the factor that decides your fitness or decides your health. It definitely is, especially when it comes to obese people. Especially if you are overweight, then that factor should be considered. But there is this big psychological issue, this BMI, body mass index, and all those things, you know, height compared to weight, and this is the ideal weight, and this is not that. No, that's not what we are going to focus on. What we will, though, focus on is substituting that fat with muscles. Now, technically speaking, it's a very, very long process. Fats don't convert into muscle. Okay, fats are energy reserves in the body, which are there, and they are used for, you know, emergency cases or for whatever. There are many reasons there. So that is our target here. It is not to lose weight, but it is primarily to gain muscles. So you may wonder why muscles? What's happening? Are we trying to becoming some bodybuilders or something? What's the significance of muscles? By the way, if you don't know about this, today's class is theory class and tomorrow's class will be a practice session or a practical class in which we will perform that exercises or some exercises which we have set for this course. Also, this course is just 8 session course, which is not at all enough to lose weight or to lose fat or to gain muscles. It's a very long process. The target of this course is to give you some basic idea about what exactly happens when it comes to, you know, weight loss or when it comes to gaining fitness or what are we supposed to do. Either you do it on your own, that is fine. If you are not encouraged enough to do it on your own, we have our sessions, regular sessions going on, and you can, as a regular guidance, you can participate in those. Like, there are so many yoga students who love doing yoga, but they just can't do yoga themselves. So they need a guide. They need a teacher to be there to tell them, okay, now take left leg to left side, right leg to right side, head to back side. So this is also a need. And that is definitely not a problem. Okay, I will not try to become this holy person and saying everyone should take care of themselves and everyone should do their own stuff. If that is happening, fine. If that is not happening, there is option B, C, D, E available. Coming back to the purpose of this course, which is primarily be going or will be focusing on muscle health or muscle strengthening. This muscle or strengthening of muscle is connected to multiple systems of the body, multiple issues in the body. For example, bones, they don't move on their own. It's the muscles which move the bones. Joints are enough to take care of themselves, but if they get help of muscles around them, that joint will be much more healthy, or else that joint will have to do overwork. If we are in a profession which needs more that activation, that joint activation, like sitting long hours or standing long hours or a lot of folding forwards or wrong position of the knees. Recently, I had this, one of my teachers was here and he was checking out some, you know, Brahmachari ashram, and he concluded that everyone here has knee pain. And he was like, he asked, what do you guys do full day? They said, we sit to eat, we sit to hear, we sit to speak, we sit to chant, we sit to meditate, we sit to read. So sitting, gone, knee gone. And then he asked, how much exercise do you do? He said, we don't do any exercise. You know, so that is not the ideal thing to do. A little bit activation is important. So first of all, muscles, they help in our joint strengthening and obviously movements. Second important aspect that muscle strengthening or working on muscles or making those muscles hungry. Now, if you are from science background, you know what are the steps. If you are not, you just take it as a thing. When muscles get hungry, or in this particular case, if we work on muscles in a particular way, there is something which is called as microtrauma. We will discuss more on this. I'm just giving you a preview of what's going to happen. There is something called as microtrauma that happens to the muscle. Microtrauma is, as the word says, microtrauma. Small trauma or some small injuries that happens to the muscle after doing a lot of work. To heal that microtrauma, body requires a lot of energy. That energy comes from creatine, it comes from some proteins, it comes from some, you know, fluids, and also that energy comes from the fastest source which is stored in the body, which is called as fat. So understand this thing. Sweating does not make you lose weight. Sitting in a steam bath, a steam room does not make you lose weight. Running like anything and sweating a lot and then not drinking any water after that will not make you lose weight. These are all myths. Even if they make you lose weight, it's not a great way to lose weight. It has a lot of risks involved. Risks of overwork involved, risks of exhaustion involved. For example, people run a lot and then they say that after running 30 minutes, I don't drink any water for 2 hours. And you know, that's how I'm losing weight. Okay, great. You may lose weight, but there's a big, big chance of you injuring yourselves, injuring your muscles, injuring your knees, getting exhausted in some time, some weeks, and ending up overeating. So this is going to be a very structured way of losing weight in which muscles will play a very big role in fat loss and not sweating and all these things. I mean, for example, I can sweat anywhere. Put me in Antarctica and I'll start sweating there. Does that mean I'll just randomly lose weight because of that? No. If you're working in kitchen on some hot, making some hot food, you will sweat a lot. Does that mean that is weight loss? No. It is just water loss. You drink water, it's back. It doesn't have any effect on weight. All right. So these are some topics that we will be covering. So let me just start my screen sharing. I've got a small presentation for all of you to make the things easy. So I call this thing as basic body fitness. And, you know, this is something which is so common, which should be so common, that each and every person on this planet should at least understand these basic things. It's not some, you know, rocket science to lose weight or to lose fat. It's common sense, but it's not that common anymore. Especially seeing the way weight pandemic is happening in the world, I definitely feel that common sense has been taken on a ride here. So as I said, we have multiple systems in the body. In this particular course, we will be discussing on only one system primarily. And that one system is the care little system. Where's my drawing pen? Here it is. Skeletal system. And muscular system. Sorry, I said one, actually there are two. Because as I said, to move our skeleton, we will need our muscles. Skeleton doesn't move on its own. If we just focus on maintaining the health of our muscular system, all these three systems, cardiovascular, which is nothing but heart and lungs, respiratory system, all these three systems will be taken care of. To gain muscle strength, obviously we need to do work. That work can be in the form of two types of exercises. I think everyone should know these basics. Aerobic and anaerobic. Anaerobic exercise is an exercise which is done in slow pace, but has a little more energy involvement, like a burst of energy. Something which is weightlifting or sprints or fast cycling or jumping jacks and tuck jumps and all that. So that comes under anaerobic form of exercise, where it's a short period of time, we are doing a lot of work. And in aerobic exercises, which are more common or more famous for weight loss, are long duration exercises, but a little less energy spent in it. For example, running, it can go on for hours or minimum, like say 15 to 20 minutes, or cycling or walking, or in a way swimming as well, or skipping. So these exercises, which can be done for a long duration and consume less amount of energy, are called as aerobic. Of course, they will consume a lot of energy because we are doing it for a long time. And on the other hand, there are anaerobic exercises, which are done for short time. As I gave example, weightlifting, we just do 10, 15 sets, repetitions, and they take like 2 minutes. And after that, we take a break. So we have intervals in it. Even HIIT is a form of nice cardio exercise or aerobic exercise. But there is this debate which keeps on going. Is HIIT aerobic or anaerobic? So some say it is aerobic, some say it is both. We say it's fine, whatever it is. We are doing it, that is more important. So just by working on our muscles, our heart is taken care of, our lungs are taken care of, and our joints are taken care of. I mean, what else do you want? As we are also a yoga school, I get a lot of questions. Is pranayam all right for everything? Will pranayam strengthen my heart? Or will a yoga practice make me, will make my muscles strong and all that? So I think I have a yoga slide coming up next. So we shall discuss that later. If any one of you has any questions, please feel free to ask questions. If you are not comfortable asking the questions in the middle, you can write down the questions and ask me later. Again, revising this particular slide, we will be primarily in this course working on the muscular system of the body, which will give us the desired results. There are a few types of trainings. Now let us discuss about them quickly because we have more important things coming up ahead. The first one here is resistance training. What is the meaning of resistance? Resisting something. If I am pushing you, you push me back. If you don't push me back, you fall down. So you're basically, I am giving you resistance. And for you to protect yourself, you are stopping me from pushing you. And in that case, what is happening? You are putting extra energy in doing something. You just imagine pushing air, thin air. Is anything happening to the muscles? Nothing is happening. I mean, it is happening, but it's not much. The muscles may not need to work hard. But if there is a resistance to the push, then the muscles have to work. See, now I'm experiencing it. 50 times more work than this. This is 50 times, almost 100% more effort needed. So that is what resistance does to our body, especially our muscles. Any form of resistance is fine, be it body weight, be it... what happened to my dog? See, my dog also becomes happy when I speak about resistance. Be it body weight, be it bands, be it weights, be it swimming, be it wrestling, be it anything. You know, that all is fine. I am not for or against any form of resistance training. You may wonder, okay, how, why is he talking about weightlifting? This is a school of yoga. Then why are you talking about weightlifting here, right? Weightlifting is nothing modern, guys. Weightlifting is ancient. Earlier, the weightlifting was done in the form of farming. There was the till, there was the a lot of things, plow, and there was seedings and this and that. Water was taken out of well. That is weightlifting. Women would do a lot of weightlifting. There was these brass cooking pots and whatnot. So there was a lot of scope for weightlifting even in the past. Just now, it has got a little more structured. That's it. Unfortunately, weightlifting is seen as only something that happens in the gym. And then there is another negative aspect to there. When we see how these gym people are exploiting their bodies, especially by taking steroids. So somehow, this weightlifting has got connected to the gymming people and to the people who, you know, make their chests like wolves and, you know, have these veins and big bodies and this and that. That is the only way weightlifting is seen. But one doesn't know that weightlifting or resistance training, to put it in a bigger picture, plays a very big role in weight loss. Yes, it is not just dieting. It is not just running. But real weight loss or real fat loss happens in resistance training. That's where the key is. No marathon runner you will ever see not doing resistance training. No person on a diet is recommended to just diet and not do any form of physical workout. So it's very, very important to understand these things about resistance training. It is not a modern thing. It is not, something which is unnatural. Like recently this happened. One of my students, he is known for his very sattvic lifestyle, and he is known for a lot of, he's a traditional guy. But he's been doing these TRX trainings and band trainings and all that. So then another traditional friend of him came up to him and said, "Are, what are you doing all this? Do some Vedic exercises. This resistance training is not Vedic. So you should not do these things and do some Vedic exercise because you are such a traditional person." Complete no-no. Complete wrong understanding of what tradition is. More than being traditional, one has to understand and be relevant. All right? So this is being relevant. Lifting weights is not something modern or non-traditional. Lifting weights has been there since ages. It's just that now it has changed. For example, communication. Now I'm talking to you through internet. Earlier it was, I would write something on a piece of paper and put it in a pigeon's neck and the pigeon would come and deliver the message. So everything is same, just the medium has changed. So please throw this thought out of your mind that gymming, weightlifting, resistance training is something modern and not good for us. It is not good for you if you are exploiting yourselves by taking these steroids and whatnot powders that are available and this workout and that workout and, you know, exploiting your body like him. Cardiovascular training, as the name says, cardio, I don't need to explain it. Running, cycling and all those things, they all fall under cardiovascular training. What is cardiovascular training? It is also resistance training. cardiovascular training is nothing but resistance training. What is the resistance given to the heart? So it is also a form of weight training, but in a different form. There is also resistance given to the legs and arms or whatever way you are doing, like running or swimming and all that. So it is still resistance training. You are not just running in the space. You are hitting against the gravity and running. You are not swimming in the space. You are swimming in the water. So there is resistance happening there as well. And then comes the third one, diet. Big word here. Or a better word for diet is caloric deficit. Because diet or dieting, I purposely wrote diet because everyone knows diet as diet. But it is not just diet. Diet means what you eat on a day-to-day basis. For weight loss or fat loss, we need to have something which is known as caloric deficit. What is caloric deficit? It's very simple. Reducing the amount of calories that we are eating. That is known as caloric deficit. We shall talk about this a little bit more in the next slides. Let us first talk about resistance training. What is resistance training? I think I've made it pretty clear. Doing weightlifting exercises. Again, if you're hell-bent that, okay, weightlifting is modern, it's non-traditional, fine. There are a lot of body weight exercises. Do those. Okay, if you don't have weights, you don't want to go to gym, your fear there is coronavirus in the gym, or there is a lot of issues happening in the gym, fine. Get some bands with you. This is what we recommend the most, using resistance bands. So if you don't have, please order one. Because these bands are nothing but one of the best ways of bringing the gym in your house. Me personally, I have all the things with me, and I bank on these bands the most, because they just provide a very big variety of weights in just my pocket. And something which is known as isometric exercises. Without going into too much details, what are isometric exercises? These are exercise positions in which there is some form of resistance, and we hold these positions for a longer time. In short, we can also call yoga practice as an isometric exercise, where we are holding one position for a longer time. So yes, yoga in that way does help in building muscles, but it's not enough, because after or while doing yoga, you should also do yoga off the mat, not just on the mat. Yoga practice doesn't finish on the mat. Yoga practice has to be carried throughout. And it all, what is that throughout? When do you sleep? How much do you sleep? What do you eat? When do you eat? How much do you drink water? I mean, it's not, should not be very less, don't worry too much also. What type of people you associate with, what work you do. So all these things, they come under yoga, and not just some asana practice which is done on the mat. So these are the form of resistance trainings. Okay. Cardio trainings, I think it's I think everyone knows what is cardio. Long walking, long range walking, fast walking, running. Plyometric exercises, it's just the PT exercises done in multiple ways, skippings, and Surya Namaskar. So Surya Namaskar, if done in a rapid manner, in a pacey way, can also be called as a cardio exercise. So here comes the asana practice. It does the job of resistance training, and Surya Namaskar does the job of cardiovascular exercise. So yes, in a way, provided you have a good lifestyle around you, a normal to intermediate yoga practice is enough to take care of all your basic fitness needs. Provided, see, there is a big asterisk here, provided everything else is intact or everything else is done justice to. But if there is, if the other part is not taken care of, you may not get the full results of a yoga practice, which are desired from a yoga practice. here comes an interesting thing. According to my understanding, these two things, swimming and wrestling, is considered as an ideal 50-50 of resistance training and cardio. This is my understanding. I may be wrong. You may challenge this thought. I don't mind. But swimming, in swimming, there is a constant resistance. At the same time, there is a constant long, practice. In wrestling as well, it's not a start-stop thing. It is a constant thing that keeps on happening. And you just see these wrestlers after their matches, they are like almost dead people. So there is a constant resistance and there is a constant cardio kind of practice which is happening as well. So it's ideal. So it's an ideal combination of both cardio and resistance. Asana practice, as I said earlier, asana practice paired with proper Surya Namaskars and some breathing exercises can also do justice to both resistance training and cardio training, provided you are taking care of other aspects of yoga and not just doing asana practice on the mat and then forgetting about everything else that is happening around. Stretching. Now, the reason why I'm mentioning this word stretching here is there is always this dual that keeps on happening. There is always this, some people say stretching is the best thing that can happen to you. And some people say this doesn't mean anything to me. And I know both of these people personally. And I myself have tried both of these things, doing stretching and not doing stretching. And somehow, both gave me similar results, me personally, but I still continue doing stretching. But I know a lot of people who are like, no, stretching is the thing. And after a workout, it's a good thing to stretch your body. It just relaxes you. It protects your muscle. But then there are cases where people are working out. They're not doing any stretching and nothing is happening. So it's a very tricky, situation. So what I did, I want you to do it the same way. You do it, see if it's help, if it helps you. If it is helping you, even if mentally, continue doing. If it is not, take the call. Like I said, when I was not doing it, nothing wrong happened to me. Because see, when we are moving our body part, one of the body part is stretching anyways. So there is stretching happening. In any movement of our body, there is no time that any muscle is not getting stretched. So that's the argument that is made by the other non-stretching party, that we don't need to stretch extra. We are already doing stretching in everything that we are doing. So I throw the ball in your court to understand whether to stretch or not after practice. In our lead classes, we do take stretching in the end, around 5 to 10 minutes. Specifically written here, yoga asana practice is not just stretching. It is much more than that. Okay, stretching is just one insignificant part of yoga practice. If you want to know more details on that, you have to come to our yoga school and attend some courses here. Then you will understand what I am talking about. Now comes our main part, the main slide or the main course of the day. How to perform fat loss. In a layman's term, okay, so this is a layman's term, not a medical term at all, and it doesn't make medical sense as well. Feeding muscles is what ideally causes fat to lose. So we have to work on our muscles. I'm just putting it in a very layman's term. There are a lot of steps in the middle. Okay, we're just jumping in. In order to lose fat, we have to have muscles as a big source for that. Or else, it may take a lot. And second, it may not be the ideal way or the safest way to do it. It may have some of the other repercussions. It may have some of the other drawbacks or side effects. How to do that, okay, I've said it, feed muscles. How to feed muscles? There are two ways of feeding muscles. One is in the gym or the playground or any place where you can perform some of the other activities. By doing what to the muscles? So now comes the interesting part. And this interesting part is something which is, okay, so from the school that I learned from, this is called as microtrauma. And there are a lot of other institutes or schools which have different names to it. Some people call it micro tear. Some people call it some roughing of the muscles and something like that. What is a microtrauma? It is a trauma that happens on the surface of the muscle. It doesn't go deep. It just lies on the surface. Now imagine this is all over as well. What is a trauma or an injury? A trauma or an injury is what happens, is which goes deep and which causes swelling in the muscle, which causes injury in the muscle, which causes bleeding in the muscle. This is the difference between microtrauma and trauma or injury. It causes tear in the muscle, which causes some deformation in the muscle. Now, for that major trauma, the healing part is a long journey where, I don't know, thousands of things are involved. You know, our body has to send a lot of energy there in multiple ways to heal that. Plus, there are medicines and this and that to fast forward the process. So here, we are not focusing on the macro trauma or the trauma. We are focusing on the micro trauma. Now, these micro tears which happen in the muscle, these are cured or these are healed by proteins and even more fastly through the fastest source in the body of energy, which is fats. So this is where the fats are recruited. Now, again, I am not saying that there are these fats and they will just jump into the muscles. Okay, this is again a long story. There are a lot of things in the middle. Don't take it on face value. But just for the sake of understanding, I am putting it this way. Okay, so if anyone knows about what happens, don't start criticizing this. You know, you go into the depth of it and understand that what exactly I am trying to say. For those who don't understand, good for you. No need to rack your brains and you can just follow and gain from what has been presented. Which muscles to focus on for fat loss or weight loss? There are these particular muscles as well. We just don't focus on any random muscle. But there are these particular muscles that we need to focus on. The number one, the first one are the thighs, because they are the biggest muscles in the body with maximum surface area. It's simple. We have to just focus on big surface areas and automatically more energy will be needed to heal the microtrauma on that surface area. So it's the thighs, then comes the back, and then comes the chest. So thighs, back and glutes both together, and then the chest. Primarily the thighs. So you'll always see people running a lot for losing weight, people doing a lot of squats and lunges for losing weight, people doing a lot of mountain climbers and this back exercises and push-ups and pull-ups. So these muscles, if we focus on, is what will cause you to lose weight properly and not just, you know, go on a diet or just keep running and all those. Those things are fine, but these things are much more important. Now comes the question, how the microtrauma is caused. It's very simple. As I said, mentioned earlier, caloric deficit, which is our next point. We have to go the opposite when it comes to muscle. What is caloric deficit? Eating a little less than what we eat, 20% less. What is this microtrauma concept? Work 20% more on that particular day. One or max 2 days a week. Ideally, it should be one because the healing needs time. It's very simple. If we are running for 20 minutes, we run for 25 minutes on that particular day. Or if we are running in 20 minutes at a speed of 5, we run for 20 minutes at the speed of 6. If we are doing 10 push-ups, we do 12 push-ups. If we are doing 50 squats, we do 70 squats. Simple. If we are doing 50 jumps, we do 70 jumps. We just increase the load, the volume of that workout by 20%. It is this simple. We just have to be very strategic in doing these things. And you will see the results coming immediately. Or else, I keep on getting these questions. I am dieting since 1 year. I am running since 2 years. I am running 1 hour per day since 2 years. Not a single gram has reduced in my body. Why? Because, my dear friend, your body has now got used to that energy expenditure. So there is no micro trauma days in your running now. You are just maintaining. So here comes my favorite topic. Maintenance, or, you know, being steady is the worst thing you can do for your muscles. Ask any businessman, what do you focus on? Breaking even every year, or, you know, keeping your business steady every year. Breaking even is a sign of loss in business, or steadiness is a sign of decline in business. You always have to go higher up, higher up, higher up, or aim for higher up. That is the only way to survive, what to speak of thrive. Same happens with our muscles. If you make them used to a particular load and you don't increase that load, the muscles will become very comfortable there. And the benefits or the advancement will go down. It's a simple understanding. If you must be wondering that, okay, why am I not losing weight in spite of doing so much workout and so much this and so much that? Because nothing is wrong with the technique. Just the approach is slightly misjudged. That steadiness, the steady factor has come in your fitness. I mean, be it running, be it walking, be it whatever. So there has to be 1 day a week, or if that is not possible, 1 day in 2 weeks, where you will have to push your limits by how much? 10%, 15%, 20%. That's it. Not more than that. That's what I'm asking you. The issue happens is a lot of people don't understand this micro trauma concept. And 1 day a week, they end up doing 50% more. And that's where two wrong things happen. First wrong thing is you get extra exhausted. Maybe you will need more break and you will end up overeating. Second wrong thing is there are high or more than high chances of injuries. When it comes to injuries, we have to be a little practical here. We are moving our body. We are moving our joints. We are putting resistance on them. Certain discomfort is bound to happen. Certain injuries are bound to happen. So don't become paranoid that I will get injured, I will get exhausted, you know, this is not meant for me. No. Movement is meant for everyone. Growth is meant for everyone. And to sustain fitness, you have to grow. You can't just be steady. All right. So this is the concept of micro trauma. Primarily focus on thighs, then secondary focus on glutes and back, and then the third one focus on chest. If you work on these muscles, take it written from me, and if you have this pattern properly set around you, 100% you will see difference in your weight gain. If not the weight gain, you will definitely see difference in your inches of the fats. Those fats will go away, and those fats will reduce for good. Okay, before I go to the next topic, let me just see what are the questions so far. Is diet more important than exercise? Someone is asking. I will come to that. Is whey protein safe to consume? I will come to that. Oh, someone, she's asking me, what is the brand to buy? Okay, I will come to that as well. I was doing 100 push-ups and one day I did 200 push-ups and then I had to take a week off. Exactly. So this happens. I mean, see, I'm not surprised or I'm not very happy that, yeah, I got you. I was right. This is common sense. Okay. So it's nothing to be very happy about for me. And nor it's very surprising to you that why this happened. Okay. So it's very, very common sense. If you have to grow, the growth has to be measured. It should, and in a very limited way, especially when it comes to this body fitness. You have to grow slowly and no need to jump. All right. So let me proceed. Second one is another type of micro trauma. So the first micro trauma was in the gym or in a playground by doing physical activity. Once a week or max once in 2 weeks, how much? 20% extra. Now the second micro trauma happens in the kitchen. So for someone who is asking me, is diet enough? According to me, no. Well, you may get results and all those things, but numbers are not enough. For example, now this is again a controversial topic, but if you can guess, who is the second highest goal scorer in the world? In football, sorry. Does anyone know who is the second highest goal scorer in football in the world? Now, football is the biggest sport in the world. I think everyone will agree. Even bigger than Olympics, some say, which is going on. India is doing miserable. Can anyone guess who's the second most goal scorer in football? Don't Google, because I'm going to give the answer in 1 minute or before you Google. Guess what? It's an Indian guy. Sunil Chhetri. Second highest goal scorer. Do you know the ranking of Indian football team in the world? It's more than 120 or 110 or definitely more than 100. And Sunil Chhetri, on number, he is the second top scorer in the world. But if you see his skill level, he doesn't even qualify to play for a second-tier group in England, English Premier League. I mean, I'm not blaming him or anything. He is a great footballer. He has done amazing things for this country. What I'm saying is, numbers are not necessarily the best statistics or the best, what you call it, path to choose. Again, let me give you a more controversial example. Cristiano Ronaldo is considered as the best footballer in the world, according to numbers. Maximum goals scored, this and that, and all those things. And a lot of people say that Messi is not that great. Not that great as Cristiano Ronaldo, because he has less goals scored than Cristiano Ronaldo. But if you'll see the overall game of these two people, Messi is a much complete footballer, even though he has less goals scored than Cristiano Ronaldo. He may have some more trophies, one trophy particularly, but when it comes to numbers, he's below Ronaldo. But if you see the fans and the majority of people who say who's the best footballer in the world, it's Messi. So it's simple. Numbers are not necessarily the right choice always. So in dieting, you may get good results when it comes to numbers, but it may not be the best thing for you. I'm not against dieting, not against caloric deficit. I have written it here that one should do caloric deficit for weight loss. But along with dieting, you have to have some form of physical activity as well. You can't afford not to make or your body move in a particular way. What particular way? Giving it resistance. So what is caloric deficit? Dieting, or what is dieting? Caloric deficit. What is caloric deficit? Reducing the food intake. Now what happens is our metabolism, our inner brain, the autonomous nervous system is very smart. It immediately catches that change in diet or reduction in diet. So it immediately adjusts, as it is very smart. You know what it will do? It will not do anything to the fats. It will reduce the metabolic needs of the body. It will reduce the energy needs of the body. And that's how it will even weaken the organs in the body, and very important organs. It will make the heart work more. It will make all the other things, you know, demand less energy. Yes, when it comes to yogis and all those things, they have very less caloric needs. But when it comes to people who are working, who are living in a non-yogic way, that may not be the best thing to happen, reducing the metabolic needs of the body. So that's where it tricks. How to trick it back? Simple. Give body work. It will not reduce metabolic needs. In fact, it may increase metabolic needs, and that's how the caloric deficit will work even more. It's like, okay, I'm getting less food. There is more demand of energy, but the food is not enough. Okay, there is the fat storage. Let me start, consuming it. And that's how fats will get reduced. Second thing, when it comes to outsmarting our metabolism, is something which is called as a metabolism cheat diet. How many of you have heard of this term, metabolism cheat diet? Has anyone heard about this? What is metabolism cheat diet? So metabolism cheat diet is, we are cheating metabolism into not reducing its metabolic needs. Now comes the good part. You know, what is metabolism cheat diet? One meal a week, you can indulge in whatever that you want to eat. So what happens is, if we are in this caloric deficit, our metabolism ends up, it starts reducing our body's caloric needs, our organs' caloric needs, and which is not necessarily a good thing, which is not a good thing for a normal person. What this metabolism cheat diet does is, it throws the metabolism off guard. By suddenly providing a lot of food, the metabolism suddenly thinks that, I don't need to reduce the energy needs because I'm getting a lot of energy. And this reduction and uprising, it doesn't happen in hours. It takes weeks. So that's why one meal a week, which is considered as a cheat meal, not a cheat day, all right? Cheat day is wrong. Cheat meal is something that can help you in not, or in letting the metabolism not harm you in a bad way while dieting. So while dieting, it doesn't mean that you just stop eating, whatever that you like and all that. That is too much big of a task to ask. So here comes a very scientific way of eating whatever you like, but only one meal a week and not more than that. Max, let's call it 5 cheat meals in a month. Okay, that is something that can be adjusted, but not more than that. And after that comes something which is called as intermittent fasting. I mean, I think everyone nowadays knows about it. It is a very common sense way of caloric deficit or giving resistance to the body. Eating for 8 hours, complete fasting only with water for remaining 16 hours. I mean, it's that simple. If you see our Vedic culture, it was the same. They would stop eating after sunset. And they would not eat until their morning sadhana or their morning rituals or whatever that they were doing in the morning were complete. Why they were not eating anything in the morning? Because if they eat anything before their whatever practice, morning practices they were doing, all the energy will go there only. Try meditating after eating. See what happens. A lot of non-meditation happens. So it was a very logical way. So this intermittent fasting is there since ages, where the people would start eating, let's say, by around 8-9-ish after completing all their morning, early morning activities, be it yoga, be it exercise, be it meditation, be it deity worship, be it whatever it is, whatever, book reading, whatever it is. And they would end it before the sun set, which is around 5 to 6. So 9 to 6, around 8 to 9 hours are done there. So intermittent fasting is there since ages, but now it is becoming more famous. You may ask that I have heard a lot that we should eat after every 3 hours to lose weight, or we should eat every 2 hours or every 2.5 hours. That is also correct. I am not against it. Try doing that and you will understand you will not be able to overeat. So that is also fine. We shall discuss this about this a little later in one of our next theory classes, because it's a very long topic. When to eat. We will not discuss about what to eat, because if we start discussing about what to eat, we may not come to conclusion for this lifetime, what to speak of this course. So what to it, what not to it, that is something to be discussed later. But what we can definitely work on is when to eat. And if that is set, then what to eat doesn't make a very big difference. It does make in some cases, but it doesn't make a very big difference on what to eat. So let me just check if there are any more questions. For intermittent fasting, is 14-10 also effective? Yes, it may not be as 100% effective as 16:8, like fasting for 16 and eating for 8. But I know a lot of people who eat for 10 hours, fast for 14 hours. That is also fine to begin with. And maybe then you can, go to 9:15. And maybe after that, you can go to 8:16. So this is the ratio followed by a lot of people. All right. Let me proceed.
Just one question.
Yes.
How frequently this intermittent fasting should be done?
Thank you. That's a very great question. I know people who do intermittent fasting for the rest of their lives, and it is fine. Why? Because you're not stopping yourselves from eating anything. You just have this 8 hours and we eat a lot, which is fine. But if you have a purpose, like a target to achieve, and then because of that, you're doing intermittent fasting. Once the target has reached, you can again fall back to your regular timing zones of eating. So both is fine. I know people who do intermittent fasting and that has become their lifestyle. And they are happy with it. As I said, we shall discuss in details about when to eat, why that when and how those whens are all, they all make sense. It's a very long discussion. We'll try to make it short in less time, in next time. But to answer your question, both is fine. It all depends on what gives you or what makes sense to you or what makes you feel better. Right? Okay, there comes the solution. After such a long talk, what is the solution? I just want 20 minutes a day. That's it. We can begin with that at least. If you think, okay, I need to work a lot, I need to jump a lot, I need to run a lot, I need to sweat a lot. No, I just want baby steps from you. Only 20 minutes a day is more than enough to begin with. Okay, I'm not going to say that it is more than enough for the rest of your life, because you always have to be progressive in life. Stagnancy will eventually lead to downfall. So 20 minutes a day is what we want. Even the workout that we'll be doing tomorrow or in our next sessions, it will be around 20 to 30 minutes and it won't go more than that. And ideally, it should not go more than 45 minutes for a normal person, unless and until you have big goals. And the second line is eat a lot, but eat good. What is eat good? You know, my dogs were barking. So let me give you the examples of my dogs. Okay, I am not demeaning you or humans in any way, but this should be a big eye opener for all the humans. Okay. What is this example, or what am I going to say next? Again, a very controversial statement. Just give a dog something which is not good for dog's health. See what the dog will do. The dog will starve to death, but will not eat something which is not good for its health. Unless and until it's a pregnant mother and it really wants that energy in any form. What's the connection? If a dog knows what is good for his or her own health without any, study and research and all that, what is wrong with us humans? Why don't we know what is not good for health? Don't we? Or do we? We do. Each and every human being, especially humans who are, mentally, not medically challenged mentally, we're not special in, come under the special category, the normal human beings, we all know what is good for our health. I can challenge all of you right now, everyone will be able to say what is good and what is bad for their own health. Try it. Try it next time before, if you have a full plate of food in front of you with like 7-8 servings, just look at that food and your brain will tell you what is good for you and what is not. It's as simple as that. It's common sense, is logic. You know, now let me give another small twist to the story. If it's okay with you, I want the participants to unmute themselves and just talk or say or take the names of the food items which are not good for health. Okay, everyone, at least take one or two names.
Butter.
Okay, one says butter. Yeah.
Samosa.
Oh, samosa. Oh, how dare you? Okay, yeah, samosa. Come on, give me more names of things which are not good for your health.
Also.
Pizza.
Okay, pizza. What? Did someone say something? Come on, name some. I want 5 more items which are not good for health.
Ice cream.
Pastry.
Sugar.
Sugar. Sugar.
Pastry.
Pastry. Batao aur. Soft drinks.
White processed sugar.
White processed sugar. Very specific. Bakery items. Okay. Okay. 2 more items. I need 2 more items. What are not good for health? Chalo, batao. I need 2 more items.
Ice cream.
Ice cream. Okay. One more item.
Okay, so white bread.
Okay, white bread.
Maggie.
Maggie. Interesting. Try saying this to, kids who are addicted to Maggie. They will disown you. Okay, so all of you mentioned some names. Now, what the interesting part here is, it's not necessary that something which is not good for you is not good for everyone. All right, so this is very bespoke. This is very custom. If you said something which is not good for you, someone may not agree to that, which is fine. And if someone else says something which is not good for them, you may not agree to it, which is also fine. So we should not get into this narrow-minded concept of what is good for us or what is good and what is bad. I can say whatever that you said, you can eat all of those things and still be fit if you eat in moderation. So what is the key here? Moderation is the key. We are not becoming fanatics. Fanatism is not the way anymore. This is happening all over now. In office culture also, that fanatic office culture is going away. There is a lot of, emphasis being given on the mental health of the office person and about all the other things and self-worth and all those things. So we are not here to become fanatics. We have to take care of our emotional well-being also, and eating good food is a big part of emotional well-being. Where does the train go off track or falls off the track is where moderation is not there. So all of the things that you have mentioned, if we have them, as I said earlier, in a cheat meal once a week, if you like having them, not like necessarily you have to eat them, then it may not harm you a lot, a lot, lot, lot. A little bit insignificant harm is fine because it's giving us emotional well-being. But whenever we are sad and depressed and we take a tub of ice cream and start eating it, that's where we are indulging. That's where we are getting addicted to it. That's where moderation goes inside a well or inside a cave and dies. So moderation is the key when it comes to not eating bad things. Or when it comes to eating bad things. Sorry, not eating bad things. Makes sense, right? If I just start saying, don't eat all these things, you may begin, but many may never end. Or many may begin, but only few may be able to completely get it. What about the others? They go to hell? No. We have to have some options for them as well. Okay, one of the very senior spiritual person was once mentioning this, that okay, we want everyone to reach a particular destination in their spiritual journey. Do you think that is the only place where everyone can go? Can't someone go to a little place which is a little different but also good? Or also spiritually, enlightened. Can't someone go to another place which is also a very spiritually elevated place? Why everyone has to go to one particular spot? So you have to have everyone in the picture here. That is called as expansion, not just elevation. One of my favorite speakers speaks about this, that we should not just work on elevating our consciousness, but we should work on expanding our consciousness as well. We should be very inclusive when it comes to understanding of such things where emotions are involved, where different personalities are involved. And this also happens when it comes to giving food, having food restrictions. If you try to suppress something, that will explode like hell. So you better do it in moderation and then work on substituting it, but not just, covering it up. That cover may not last. As we are a yoga school, I have to end with yoga. Yoga practice is not just an asana practice. Please understand this. Yoga practice is a way of living. It's a way of living. It's a way of living what? A balanced lifestyle. Now, this balanced lifestyle can be misjudged by a lot of people. Or if a smart person can very easily say that, we should have balance in life, so let's do bad things also in balance. Not necessarily you have to maintain that. I'm not saying don't do bad things. Everyone does bad things. But we have to always work on becoming better. So same thing happens with the bad food habits. I'm not saying stop them. I'm saying moderate them and work on making going better and better. I will give my own example. How since my last 10 years, I have been working on this moderation principle on eating. And since last 10 years, I have very successfully cancelled out naturally all these bad foods, quote unquote, bad foods that I was liking or I was, indulging in. And now there is only one or two item that is remaining, and that is also gone really, really low. So it's as simple as that. It's not one day's job that suddenly we get up and you're like, okay, now no bad food. No, it doesn't happen that way. Okay. So it's a balanced lifestyle with a strong impetus on becoming better, not just being balanced, but being better balanced and then going better and then better and then bettering the balance and not just being having a stagnant balance. That's why I know a lot of people who quote yoga and say, we should do everything in balance. So we should drink wine in balance also. We should give bad words in balance also. So that balance somehow gets imbalanced when negative things are attached to it. The benefits of yoga are only derived if we do justice to all the aspects of it and not just the asana and pranayama part. Else, it will just work as a hack and not a permanent solution. So please don't take yoga as a hack or some hustling thing that you're doing or somehow hustling your way out of certain things. It will not be a permanent solution if you only have a very narrow-minded approach on yoga. All right, so this was our first intro session. Following tomorrow's session, we will be discussing, we will be actually practicing a form of workouts that we have designed, specifically designed for weight loss, fat loss, and physical fitness as well. in which all the body parts of the body, all the muscles of the body will be taken care of in terms of strengthening them. And in a long term, we have a 6-month schedule with us, which can do wonders for your weight loss, or what I like to call it as fat loss. So I would like to stop the session, conclude the session here. If you have any questions, please ask, or if you want, you can type in the chat box as well.
So one question, yes, can we practice yoga and this fat loss together, combination of both?
Again, this is a very personal thing. So I know a lot of people who don't do resistance training at all, but they do asana practice every day and they are fine. I know a lot of people who don't do asana practice at all. They do resistance training every day. That's how they connect to fitness. They are fine. I know a lot of people who do alternate days, or maybe 2 days asana practice, 3 days resistance, or 3 day resistance, 2 day asana practice, and they are also fine. So it all depends on how you connect it to and how it connects to you. It's like that. It's a verb. It's not a noun. So we can't just say that, okay, this is how it is, but it is how you connect to it. That is how it is. So you have to now make that call of how much to do, what to do, and when to do.
Thank you.
Okay. Are there any other questions? Any other doubts regarding the class, regarding the session, regarding the course? All right. So if there are no further questions, I shall end this session. Thank you very much for your enthusiastic participation. And I hope that you have got something, a better perspective of weight loss, because whenever I Google weight loss, or whenever I go on YouTube for weight loss, all I get is what to eat, what not to eat, and what exercise to do. But what we have spoken about today is why to do those exercises and how those exercises will have an impact on you. Why to do dieting and how that dieting will impact. Oh, yes, this question was there about whey protein. How many more people has this question? Because in every session, I get this question on whey protein. There's a lot of discussion happening on this. So here is my take on it. There are a lot of people saying a lot of things about it. So even I am saying this thing about it. If you are taking whey protein, you have to take it with one oath or with one pledge. What is that pledge? I will keep on working out for the rest of my life, in some form or the other. I will not stop any form of physical practice that I'm doing, exercise that I'm doing, and I will just take whey protein. Why I say this is because whey protein is a liquid powdered form of protein. The body doesn't need a lot of work to do to, you know, absorb it. And that's how our digestive system becomes a little lethargic if we don't put that energy demand in. So what happens is the digestive system becomes used to easy form of digestible proteins. High protein food is not easy to digest. It's like sprouts and non-veg and you know, a lot of such, you know, chanas and rajmas and soya beans, not easy to digest. But whey protein, it goes in like a powdered form. So that's where the digestive system gets tricked. And that's how it becomes an issue. And that's why you will see a lot of people who are addicted to these whey proteins and you go to this gymming. As soon as they stop gymming, they obviously have to stop whey protein. Irrespective of that, if they stop or they don't stop, you will see them blowing up. They become huge. They become massive when it comes to fats. What has happened is because the body was used to digesting or getting these proteins, it itself reduces its energy of, you know, synthesis of protein and absorption of protein. And that's how a lot of protein goes undigested and gets stored as fat. And that's why this bloating or, you know, blowing up of people happens after stopping their whey proteins. So this is my take on it. I don't mind if it's working for you without doing any exercise. But from my side, if you are taking whey protein, you have to take it if you have to continue doing some or the other form of exercise. When it comes to which company, there are a lot of companies. What I don't personally like is combinations. So there are these some whey proteins which have a lot of other things in it as well. As it is, it's not the most ideal thing, but if there are these other boosters in it, you know, what are these boosters? They go and impact your hormonal system. They make you produce a lot of hormones, especially the growth hormones and all those things. It stimulates the adrenal gland and other glands, obviously. So that's what I don't recommend a lot. The proteins with combinations, you know, this thing and that thing and this pill and that pill. So don't overdo it. Just have normal whey, plain whey. That's it. That is my take on whey protein. So thank you very much, everyone. And I hope to see you again. And I hope that you have gained something out of this session. And yeah, I will see you soon. Thank you very much. Namaste.
Thank you.